Welcome to our second to last, our penultimate seminar. We are very pleased that we have Mama Afia Zakiya, who I've known for 16 years. Some of you are looking at me like you think I'm 16 years old. How long can this have been? But indeed, she deals a lot in water, sanitation, and hygiene. And because she deals with water so much, I've given her the name Mami Wata. But again, we're very pleased to have her today. And what I'll do, I'll introduce our chair for today. We have the illustrious and praiseworthy Dr. Godwin Kwafo Adjei, a research fellow, an ethnomusicologist and head of the music and dance section here. His scholarship deals court music, chieftaincy in general, Asafo music, youth cultures, music and politics. And as he deals with culture, youth cultures, and we're dealing with the significance of culture, we thought that he would be a perfect chair. So with no further ado, I'll turn it over to the honorable, praiseworthy, and illustrious Dr. Godwin Kwafo Adjei.
Thank you, our honorable coordinator, Obadeli. You are welcome once again. And you know that I just want to say a few things about the presenter for today in the person of Afia Zakiya. She holds a PhD in political science, African and Africana women's studies, a dual master's in organizational development and change and public policy, and a bachelor's degree in business administration. In fact, she is the country representative for WaterAid Ghana. And since 2010, Dr. Zakiya provides a strategic leadership and vision for a team of 27 to provide access to clean, safe water, improve sanitation and hygiene for poor and marginalized communities based on culturally appropriate program. Based on culturally appropriate program. And for this semester, a lot has been said about the importance of culture. So she's going to stress that very much for us to understand it maybe far better than we've heard from other people. Just a few things about her publications. She's a published scholar and renowned speaker. So you'll be hearing from her very soon, how she can speak so well to gatherings here and there. Recent publications include 2014, that is Centering African Culture in Water, Sanitation and Hygiene Development Practices in Ghana. A case for indigenous development in practice. And the second one, 2013, women's political participation in Nigeria. And using the 2007 general elections in Nigeria. The last but not the least, Dr. Zakiya is a member of numerous international professional associations. No wonder she can speak very well. In 2014, she became a founding member of the African Studies Association of Africa at the University of Ghana, Lagos. She currently resides in Accra, Ghana and Atlanta, Georgia with her family. So, you're welcome, and I hand over the mic to you for
the presentation. Okay, thank you, sir. Well, good morning, everyone. I'm very pleased to be invited to speak to you today. And of course, as my son Obadele has said, we've known each other for some time, so I could not refuse the request from him to come and speak. I've seen the other speakers, and so I know that there have been many profound discussions that have been held before me, so I hope I can just make some small contribution to this lecture series that's happening at this fine institution. I want to ask for permission to speak from my elders, the canon. Thank you. And of course, the topic today since we want to go right into the discussion, is entitled Decolonizing Knowledge on Water, Sanitation, and Hygiene in Africa, the Significance of African Culture. My central thesis is that there is a growing amount of literature in this area of development that is focusing on Africa and its people. And it seeks to particularly explain the reasons why access to water has not led to the believed changes that should happen in terms of hygiene and sanitation practices. And so my paper will discuss some of the emerging literature and research that's being done to give some explanation as to why this is happening, including some of the findings that we're having or that I've been seeing here in Ghana, but also with I'll make reference to some work in Nigeria. And so the argument is that part of the solutions that have been coming will not hit the mark because they tend to deal with the manifestations of culture, the behavior of African communities and individuals, and not the deep structural culture of the people, and particularly the symbolic and spiritual meanings that they have attached to water, sanitation, and hygiene, and how these interact to determine the manifestations of culture, which is the behavior that people talk about. And so what I call for is an approach that decolonizes some of the research and the conversation about WASH and why African communities and people are so-called behaving as they are and not practicing good sanitation and hygiene, and offer an agenda on how we need to maybe go forward in this research. And then, of course, advocating for the role of African-centered scholars and scientists, cultural scientists, but also institutions such as the Institute for African Studies, just to make the case that there is a role for the work that is being done to help uncover the African cultural meanings around water, sanitation, and hygiene. So in Ghana, we have the case of statistics that you will hear in terms of the provision of water. The government says that we have about 87% national coverage for water. Of course, the issue with that is that the coverage is uneven, inadequate, and unreliable. So depending on where you are, depending on your socioeconomic status, you may or may not have water on any given day. But in the WASH sector itself, there have been more calls in the recent years for improved delivery of water, sanitation, and hygiene by linking the provision of WASH to improved health outcomes. So especially in the area of hygiene and sanitation practices. So the argument now is that we need more water and water, sanitation, and hygiene to improve the overall health and well-being of individuals, not only health, also improve livelihoods and the general broader development of communities. However, in terms of sanitation, we find that the sanitation, which here we're talking about improved toilets, people who have improved toilet facilities, the coverage in Ghana is only around 15 or 18%. And this has only changed by 3%, three percentages since 2010. And one of the main things that you'll hear is discussions around open defecation, where the name speaks for itself, the concept speaks for itself, and that this behavior is around 19% of the 24 million people here in Ghana, mainly in the north, they say, and despite messages around the linkages between open defecation and illnesses and even waterborne diseases, we haven't seemed to make headway in changing the practices of open defecation in Ghana. So this situation is being problematized by government, by bilateral and multilateral organizations. And interestingly, the response, though, has been to move away from direct provision of not so much water facilities, but more so sanitation. The national policy around sanitation is mainly based on the approach called community-led total sanitation, where at the end of the day, individuals and communities are asked to now build their toilets, even if it's just a pit latrine, using their own resources. And if they don't have money to build toilets or improve latrines, then the obvious solution now is to offer communities credit schemes. So with the credit schemes and with the growing privatization generally of both water and sanitation services on the rise, you have challenges increasingly, times are becoming actually more increasingly difficult for the poorest and most marginalized communities who can't afford either to build or buy toilet facilities or even to have the water facilities that they may need. So the research that is emerging around this situation generally just calls for more government intervention to provide these facilities, and now private actors are coming in. You know, we have the privatization of water in Ghana. We have the utility regulators and everybody coming in to really limit and regulate the access to water. So my central argument again is that the desired hygiene and sanitation behavior changes called by the actors in the water sector will not emerge and have the intended and lasting impact until an understanding of African people and the role of culture and ideology in shaping their historical and contemporary relations with and conceptualizations of water, sanitation, and hygiene is unearthed and used to inform what happens, which is a question of epistemology, and drive the methods and approaches to development interventions, we won't really see the changes that people are calling for. The behavioral practices deemed inappropriate or lacking among African or Ghanaians are at best manifestations of culture and not the deep culture of the people that must be understood to shape behavior change communication messages or any others that come to bring about improved sanitation and hygiene practices that will have the desired health impact at different levels and within different contexts that people find themselves. A quick review of the literature shows that some interesting research is happening in Africa by African scholars such as Emmanuel Akpabio of Nigeria, Professor David Millar, who I'm sure you all know here in Ghana. And on the side that will help to address and support deeper meanings around culture and behavior change, I have been drawn to the work of Professor Wade Nobles, who is a pioneer in the creation of the field of African psychology. So all of their writings show that we cannot solve the problem of water sanitation and hygiene in Africa without reference to the general dialectics and context of the behavior of culture and environment and how these three things interact to shape people's understandings and meanings. Akpabio's work in Nigeria indicates how the existing literature on water and sanitation seems loose and soft, as he calls it, because it does not employ thorough analytical methods or techniques as well as appropriate and relevant indigenous concepts in understanding these issues from the perspective of cultural communities in Africa. He offers what he calls the local or traditional ecological framework, to improve our understanding of the complex issues related to water and sanitation in Nigeria. What the work of Dr. Noble shows us is that human transformation must be guided by critical thought that reflects the ideological aspects of one's culture. He shows us how societies transform when the institutions within them change, and institutions change when the cultural base, in particular the ideology upon which they are founded, change. His definition of culture is instructive and used to shape the discussion here today in terms of what I mean when I'm talking about culture. And he defines culture as a scientific construct representing the vast structure of language, behavior, customs, knowledge, symbols, ideas, and values which provide a people with a general design for living and patterns for interpreting reality. The examination of culture and its relationships to the meaning of a people's reality occurs by examining three things, or three aspects. First, the factors of culture, which consist of cosmology, ontology, and axiology. The emergent aspects of culture, which includes ideology, ethos, and worldview. And then he talks about the manifestations of culture, which are customs, behavior, language, symbols, ideas, and values. And I'm stressing the behavior because I believe that that's mainly what people look at when they talk about the issues of inappropriate sanitation and hygiene practices in Ghana and indeed across Africa. In Ghana, we have the work, the exciting work of Professor David Millar, his concept of cosmovision, which is relevant and promotes indigenous development, is also something to draw upon. His concept of cosmovision shows, which he has based primarily on doing research in northern Ghana, rural societies there. And he shows how the culture of most African societies in northern Ghana represent the interaction of the spiritual, social, and material worlds to generate complex and multiple constellations of knowledge and ways of knowing. So he says that if you are want to understand the wash meanings and interpretations of people in many of the northern Ghanaian societies, but I also believe it's a relevant concept, cosmovision, to most of African societies because of the emphasis of the spirituality of African people. He says that local knowledge is generated in several ways. People either have spiritual meanings only to things that happen in their environment. They may combine both spiritual and social aspects of their world. They may only look at social interactions. They may look at only material interactions. They may look at material and spiritual world aspects. But then he says, in terms of cosmovision, the ideal state of knowing in African societies is when, of course, the spiritual, material, and social realities are in a perfect state of existence. And when people are able to use all three of these ways of knowing and being to define their reality, and I would say that that balance and harmony that he talks about speaks to Ma'at, an ancient Kemetic word that describes a way of living and being that is also requires understanding of harmony and balance, also justice, righteousness, and other concepts. So looking at the work of Nobles, Millar, and Akpabio, we now begin to have a framework emerging and some exciting work and research that's being done, where what we have emerging is that the idea where the values of a people are an important part of their knowledge system, but that it constitutes an important channel for moral codes that also determine behaviors that you find among groups in their particular environment. So what is important for us will be the particular symbolic and spiritual meanings that are attached to water, sanitation, and hygiene among Africans, where health and disease are construed. And I want to now go into this a little bit deeper to show some of the findings that they have, because this issue around the importance of sanitation and hygiene now in the WASH sector, as I mentioned early on, is being strongly linked to issues of health and well-being. And so how do African societies and people construe the transmission of diseases, cholera, for example, diarrhea, for example? What is it that their culture and worldview, cosmovision, is saying about these things that I'm arguing the research and policies that are coming out in the WASH sector are missing? So in terms of WASH health and disease, I want to unpack the cultural dimension. In terms of health and WASH, Akpabio's work in particular shows how Western healthcare practitioners rely on intervention programs using Western cultural constructs and science. Such constructs are focused on documenting and understanding what he calls the strategic disruption, interruption, or weakening of the chain of disease transmission pathways. In this paradigm, water mediates the transmission of microorganisms or parasites onto humans, while unsafe sanitation practices and lack of environmental hygiene catalyze the spread of infections. This diagram that I'm projecting here shows, depicts what the traditional Western concept of disease transmission is, and in particular, it's showing an issue that we all know and hear most about, and that is diarrhea. So if people are practicing open defecation, the Western health world will come and say, okay, you have feces that is out in the open, and if you see the different ways that feces can be transmitted to humans through fingers, through fluids, through flies, you know, different ways, and then it becomes these things touch food, and then when people ingest the food, they have diarrhea or other illnesses that may come. So for many years, this is the picture that we have. And even when we talk about other kinds of waterborne diseases, like cholera, for example, people will link that with unsafe hygiene and sanitary practices. So they link disease epidemics to water supply and sanitation, and identify what, in their conceptualization, are the pathways of transmitting diseases. However, one of the things that Akpabio's research is showing is that, at best, the solutions that come from these beliefs by Western-trained health practitioners and those in the WASH sector who are also projecting this understanding is that normally these actors are outside of the immediate social and ecological situation, and so they recognize and prescribe solutions, again, without knowing the deep cultural understanding or meanings of the people. And then you have what he says is an elite group of people who are using what he says are all the instruments of state resources to promote sanctioned knowledge practices, even if it is obviously outside the norms of the local knowledge systems. And so you have this, of course, this tension between the outsider and the local person and their understanding about how disease is happening and illness is occurring in their communities. Again, what I am finding is that the role of cultural beliefs, local scientific and spiritual knowledge, norms, values, and spirituality in influencing the broader context of behaviors are seen, are said to foster the contaminations that cause the diseases to spread. In an extensive review of the literature, Jewett captured both the spatial and temporal dimension of culture and environmental factors that constrain Western-based intervention efforts at addressing water and sanitation in so-called developing countries. One of the things that his research is finding that different communities may have taboos and ambivalence surrounding human excrement, and that these taboos, for example, he cited some research that he did in Madagascar, where storing sewage underground was a taboo because of fear of contaminating the dead, and then putting one's feces on top of another was also seen as, you know, a taboo. And so when people were advocating for the use of what we call drop and store waste systems, or latrines or toilets, pit latrines or toilets, the people were not responding to that. They would continue to practice open defecation. But people were confused. Why, even if we build a toilet, they won't use the toilet? And we know that in Ghana, from our work in WaterAid, but just in general, the widespread practice of open defecation, and it's not just in northern Ghana. We all know that people are, using, defecating in rivers and beaches and many other places, even in the cities, and that we have problems of urban slums in Ghana where open defecation is practiced. So in theoretical terms, this research that is emerging is really fascinating, because the social conceptions of disgust vary enormously between different places and cultures and is rarely static. What is offensive and disgusting to one to a society at one point may change. It's not that people are frozen in their thinking about concepts of disgust, for example. So indeed, if we were to take the conventional discourse on hygiene and sanitation at face value, one would think, by the images and pictures that we see, that African people never had any idea or any understanding or notion of unhygienic behavior, whether at an individual or within their environment. And so, but I think we're going to show in a moment that historical evidence using African proverbs and other research shows that this is not the case. But we see pictures all the time of African children and people in the villages with flies on their faces. The environment is always unclean. The people themselves are unclean and, you know, looking like, oh, they haven't had a bath, you know, in days. So we need to come in and save them and teach them how to be hygienic and have the right sanitation. This is some of the things that we'll see, that we tend to see. Let me just try to move quickly and show, I don't know if you're able to see that. Can you see the writing? I just want to show some of the findings in terms of the research that is being done by Emmanuel Akpabio in Nigeria. He has done his research among the Ibibio, Among, and Oron ethnic groups. And so what he did was to go in and document the cultural and symbolic meanings attached to water, sanitation, and hygiene, also spiritual meanings. So when he looked at the local beliefs of the people around water, he said he found that, of course, for them, water had a sense of purity. It was divine. In terms of the worldview, then water was seen as divine and sacred. And then in terms of manifestations, he uncovers different proverbs. And the first one, do we have someone from Nigeria here, or who can maybe read the proverb for us, so I can try and butcher the language, but since we can be interactive now, if there's someone who can read it. Anyway, the local proverb says, if we don't have anyone from Nigeria to read it, I'll just give the English meaning, but you'll forgive me if I do that, that it is only water that can wash away dirt. And he talks about how water cannot harm. So in the traditional societies he studied, the issues of industrial water pollution are relatively unheard of. It was relatively unheard of in those communities. So a behavior change could be possible if water pollution were to be shown as a problem in the community. And then he talked about the use of holy water because of the sense of purity and it being seen as divine and sacred. And then he also talked about where he saw that the purity exemplifies the cleansing power of water, which forms the basis of ritual baths. So he looked at the deep structural meanings of culture, deep structural meanings of water, where it talks of, where he found it had a sense of purity and meaning of being a divine source. Then he looked at, documented how among the people, the water was seen as the home of spirit and deities and ancestors. And so there was an unquestioning use of water irrespective of the quality, even for different rituals. And then water is believed to offer healing powers to some human problems upon drinking the water. So even if the quality of the water was changing, people were still relying and using the water for different reasons. And this is things that in the traditional WASH literature and research, you don't hear about these kinds of things and meanings that, that communities have. I'll just, in the interest of time, go to another aspect of his research. He found ideas around cleanliness, proverbs that were there that talked about the need for physical cleanliness as beauty. He found sanitary taboos. Unsanitary people, especially women, are not to be stigmatized. You do not say a woman smells or is dirty, for example. And then something that was really interesting is around child health and well-being. In the villages that he did his research, he found that children's health was believed to be in the protective hands of the gods. And the proverb is there. And so children's excretia are regarded as inoffensive. So if a child is practicing open defecation or out in the open in the community, people did not see that as something offensive and unsanitary and uncleanly, you know, a sign of uncleanliness. And in fact, children in the villages are encouraged to play out in the dirt, to play outside. And even and so, of course, with that happening, they may come in contact with excretia. But the ingestion of it or anything else like that was not seen as something that was harmful. In terms of one last area, some of the other practices that he saw relating to infant and child hygiene. The worldview among the Yoruba was that children's health and hygiene was linked to parental bond and inoffensiveness of child waste products. I think I mentioned that before. But one of the things that happens that he saw was that parents an elder spit in saliva into the mouth of an infant, and that doing things like that when they were cleaning or things like that where we may say that they could, the parent could have been transmitting some kind of, transmitting some disease or something to the child. This was not seen as something that was offensive if parents did that. Swaddling clothes are mostly washed at home by hand and reused. So a lot of different things are coming out in the research that is relevant for us to understand if we're going to create messages that are going to go beyond just the behaviors and get to the deep cultural meanings, symbolic, spiritual, and otherwise, that people have around water, sanitation, and hygiene. So the cornerstone in the understanding of human reality is found in the notion of meaning. The cornerstone in the understanding of human reality is found in the notion of meaning. We all have and see different meanings attached to water, sanitation, and hygiene. In terms of Ghana, and this is where Dr. Cambon will help me. We have seen some Akan proverbs related to wash.
The first one, when a child sees his or her hands and washes them, he or she eats with elders. Bad upbringing is the reason why the vulture ate feces. When a woman stays too long in the bathroom, she is going through a thorough cleansing or cleaning process. When the old woman goes to the river in the morning, she blesses herself in the evening. Which is before the rain fell, the bathing place was already wet. And I think this is also very appropriate in terms of we already had sanitation solutions before. It is because of wickedness that the wasp made a type of honey without water inside. When the chicken drinks water, it shows it to Onyonkopon, the creator. And when the frog falls into boiling water, it realizes that there are different types of water.
Just last week, I was in the Bongo district, and we were having a program. We were inaugurating in a community a team that we call the Water and Sanitation Management Team. And this team is put in place in a lot of our programs to manage the water facilities that they have in their communities. And so during the launch, people were admonishing the community about being clean and hygienic and practicing good sanitation. And again, in my mind, it was just like, okay, people are talking to them as if the community didn't have any concept or idea about, sanitation and being clean. So I just stopped, when my turn came. The first thing I asked the community was to give me two proverbs that talk about your understanding of sanitation and hygiene practices before the Europeans came, or before the regional minister came, or before any of us came to your community. And I wanted the proverb to be something that I asked the oldest person that was there, who had to be at least 75 or 80 years old, to give me the two proverbs. And the two proverbs are here that was shared. Now I'm going to try this, so bear with me. Unless we have someone from the Anafobisi community from Bongo District. Do we have anyone who speaks the Boon language? Okay, so I'll try. Here we go. P sugru bonanga buru. The sting of a scorpion should not deter one from cleaning his or her compound of bushes. Fohan ka piha ho yiri bansi na paho. If you don't clean your environment, you can contract any disease. So these were the two proverbs that the elder gave us during our discussion. So it shows to me that definitely the community had some concept of being clean, because the picture that comes to us in the literature when our partners go and do what we call community entry and they'll document the status of the community, what they'll initially give me is the number of people, the population, what the water coverage is, high prevalence. They'll talk about sanitation and hygiene, and they'll talk about high prevalence of open defecation, indiscriminate disposal of solid waste, especially these black polythene bags, and just the absence of soakaways in households, all these negative things. And it's always, you know, something always hits me in my mind to say that I can't believe that our people don't have any concept of what it means to have hygiene and sanitary environment. It can't always have been like this. So the question really is why, especially in rural communities, when we know that one of the first things that people would do when they wake up is to go out and clean their area in the compound from any dirt or any waste. You know, what is happening and why is that breaking down? I think that is the challenge. So my last 5 minutes is to talk about then this idea of decolonizing the research and the understandings on WASH, and how do we do that. As I'm demonstrating, some of the things that we have to begin to do is to research and uncover and use methodologies that can be used to create African knowledge on WASH issues, including having African indigenous interpretations of WASH that exist via proverbs, assessments of local beliefs associated with key WASH elements, focusing on the beliefs and practices associated with childcare, particularly because we know that the data on child and infant mortality is very high, and particularly associated with diarrhea. But we also have to look at local healing practices and concepts and sources of wellness and illness and how these are transmitted. We have to unpack indigenous knowledge of local myths, taboos around WASH, and then we have to understand indigenous psychology on human behavior and transformation. How does change happen? Human social change happen, individual change happen among African people and in the communities. And of course, if the research is going to be decolonized, it should be led by Africans who have the interest of African people and communities at heart for the most part. And in this regard, I draw upon the work of a Native American indigenous person, Linda Tawiya Smith, who her book on decolonizing methodologies is a source that I use in my teaching research methods course, where she talks about important issues that define an agenda for shaping indigenous methodologies. Some of the things that we have to ask is, who is the research for? Who will own it? Whose interest does it serve? Who will benefit from it? How have the questions been designed and framed with indigenous worldview in mind? Looking at the research and the theory around research from an indigenous perspective. And then, of course, including local people and indigenous people, not as objects, but rather as participants in the research that is being done, and then using appropriate language and form in order to communicate research results back to the people. So in this notion of feeding back any research or information to the communities is very important. But one of the things that she also talks about in terms of decolonizing research and methodologies is that the indigenous research agenda should include healing, mobilization, transformation, and decolonization on many levels. And just to show you this research model that she has, she is showing how the indigenous research agenda should take into consideration survival, recovery, and development of the communities, which are conditions and states of being that many indigenous communities, including African indigenous communities, are moving through. So there's a process of uncovering information, and the intent behind uncovering the information is part of what is essential in the decolonizing process. And of course she says that indigenous methodology is based on indigenous epistemology and ontology. It articulates a reciprocal relationship between the researcher and the researched, who must become a family and be interconnected in reciprocal ways in the frames of the particular research project of which they are involved. And here I'm of course talking about a lot of the research that's coming out in the water, sanitation, and hygiene sector. So to conclude, it is becoming very apparent that science has become the critical thought of a society. And this is the case in many African societies, and not just in the West, because the work that Professor Millar and others have done shows very clearly that African indigenous knowledge is science. And it is based on experience and other ways of knowing that sometimes are not recognized in traditional Western societies. The other thing that is becoming clear is that we need to take a Sankofan approach to and an endogenous development approach to understanding how local sociocultural norms surrounding water, sanitation, and hygiene influence communities beyond surface levels, but rather at the deep structural levels, and shape their beliefs around WASH, but also their wider political, physical, and environmental spaces. Finally, we need more African-centered NGOs, research centers, and think tanks, and to train community members, and especially a cadre of young youth, to research this topic so that they can study and generate ideas on the social and psychological development of our people and the social structures and institutions that ultimately foster human transformation that affirms the well-being of African people. So I think I will stop there. My time is up, and be glad to have any comments and feedbacks. Thank you.
Thank you, Afia. Thank you very much. Can we do it better? So, the long and short of it all is that culture should be seen, we should use culture as the foundation of our development. Culture should serve as the foundation of our development. So, on this note, I open the floor for questions, contributions, observations. We take three at a go, and then others will follow later. Yeah, Obadeli.
All right. Mami Wata, thank you for that riveting and engaging presentation. As you were speaking, I was thinking about Fela as a source of information on WASH. He has a song, ITT, where he says, long, long, long time ago, that we didn't carry SHI. That it was white man's culture to carry that, but what we did, we used to do it inside of a big, big hole. Then he goes all throughout the continent and gives what the name of that big, big hole was for Akanla, not TFE. I'm thinking
about the implications of that research. It's a song, but it's actually very deep research that he did, that the people know that there's some type of connection between, you know, the feces and sickness. That's why, that's for our culture. We're not defecating at our house. And that brings me to the question of, is what we happen to see continental Africans doing right now an indication of what we may have been doing far back into our past? So, you know, we know colonialism, we know people are wearing used clothes, all these things that show a change has taken place. So can we go to a rural community and assume that what we're seeing them doing now is an indication of what they may have been doing in their culture in the more remote past? Another one in terms of Fela, he has, Omi Olo Tao, Water No Get Enemy. You know, he says, Bobas Obe Omi Lo Malo, if you want to cook soup, what are you going to use? Basically, another research song using all of these different African proverbs, Yoruba proverbs specifically, to show the indispensability of water. So I'm looking at alternative sources as well for indigenous knowledge, including Afrobeat.
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed your topic, and it's very, very exciting. I have got a few comments that probably you may wish to consider it to make it more exciting. In your literature review, I heard you discuss largely two works, one by Ghanaian, another by Nigerian, on what they've done on WASH. I think WASH is a popular acronym, not only for your project, but other international organizations that are doing projects on WASH. And probably before you critique them, it would be good to look at other technical reports or other kinds of documentation by other NGOs and organizations that are doing works on similar things, which they also call WASH, water, sanitation, hygiene, in the country and across the continent. After you have done that, then you will know what exists in the country, Ghana, and probably in other countries. Then you'll be able to know their approaches, whether it is imposing Western models or working in collaboration with local people. We may all have ideas, but until you demonstrate this with the citation of examples of what others are doing with WASH in the country and in other places, it is not unfair. It is unfair to make, you know, the judgment if you haven't looked at what others are doing with the WASH. My other thing too is that we are all aware of the challenges many African countries face and the challenges of setting up African-based NGOs. But I think also it's difficult to just say Africans should lead Africans. Yes, in theory, yeah, that's it. But in practice, I think we should also recognize the problems that African NGOs, you know, face. And then in recommending for African leadership with water and sanitation, you will be able to cite more appropriate, more specific examples and directions to where they go if you recognize the problems which they face in the country. My last one is about one of the first things I learned as a student here was the Akan concept of sacred and profane. And one of my first fundamental lessons I learned under Professor Hagen's class, in fact, Professor Odoba was in that class, the sacred and the profane. And one of the things they have a concept about the hand left, because you use the hand left to wipe your backside. And because of that, they've got many problems, like you don't use your left hand to point your father's house. When I'm coming to greet you where you're seated, I will not start from that side, because it's considered wrong. I have to start from my right side. Do you see? So in addition to what you said, the local people themselves are very clear in their mind as to what left or the profane stands for and what the right stands for. And so there's a gap between these philosophical concepts and what is happening on the ground. What happened? What has led to these changes? And how can you or how can we address it? Thank you.
Okay, considering the length of the second, I want you to respond, and then we'll take the next set.
There's not much I can say. I'm definitely aware of his music and his work. I often play his song, Water Got No Enemy. In fact, did I get it from you? I heard it someplace, and you had the copy of it. But I have several water songs that have been made by various artists that are talking about the importance of water in society. So, definitely, and it ties similar to part of the question from the second person. You know, what is the gap? What has happened to why we see? We know that there are proverbs, there are sayings, there are understandings that existed, and so, but why then do we see the behaviors that we see now and practices that we see now in terms of open defecation in communities? Why do we see the poly these black bag things, you know, everywhere? Even now in rural communities, you go there in Bongo District, outside of the community where we had our project going, all around surrounding was trash and the bags. And you ask, you know, why? I don't know why. That's what I'm here to talk about, and that is what the work of, you know, cultural scientists, I believe that the answer is going to come in looking at going beyond the manifestations of culture, which is the behavior, to find out the meanings that people have attached to these behaviors and how the institutions, the cultural systems in their societies, those who are the keepers of the traditions, those who are the keepers and leaders of the main institutions and social structures that guide and shape behavior and thought and ideology, that we need to understand those and then come out with messages and interventions, I think, that may take us where we think we need to go on that. But in terms of looking at other research in Ghana, looking at what other NGOs are doing, well, I've been doing that, but I was told I only had about 30 or 40 minutes. So I chose to highlight research by scholars that I think is leading us towards some of the solutions on in terms of research on WASH that we need to look at. And look at what others are doing. I think I am fairly aware of what a lot of other organizations, especially in the INGO and local organizations, are doing. I just want to clarify that my presentation and my discussion are my views. It's not that of WaterAid. But in terms of our work at WaterAid, one of the things that I've been trying to do is to promote endogenous development as one of our approaches to development, which of course it has the premise that culture drives development. So we work with the Center for Indigenous Knowledge and Organizational Development. Professor Malar is on my advisory committee for my organization. So I'm trying to do different things and bring people in to help us really look at what is happening in the sector. But of course, by working for WaterAid, which is an international organization, every day I'm reading about what is happening in the WASH sector. I participate at the national level with the ministries, the water and sanitation sector working groups. I read every policy document that is coming out on water, sanitation, and hygiene in Ghana, and indeed across Africa. So I think I'm not generalizing in terms of what I think is the dominant approaches to water, sanitation, and hygiene, not only in Ghana, but in Africa, and I still find it wanting.
Thank you for your wonderful presentation. I have one observation and a question. My observation has to do with the content of your presentation. If I were you, I would have focused on sanitation and hygiene as a subject of investigation, and then do the methodology as a separate subject entirely. It was very difficult to see the connection, and you didn't have enough time to spend really on methodology. My other observation is that whatever we call Western paradigm, we tend to assume that the paradigm is brought about by white people in the West. I've lived long enough to know that a lot of Africans and people of African descent are involved in this research before the paradigm is brought in. WHO, World Health Organization, involves a lot of us in looking at indigenous dimensions before we prescribe any kind of solution to the problems. So let me ask my question then. I think it's very clear, I want to reemphasize what Dr. Labi has just said, that Africa have expressions, they know about hygiene, they know about sanitation, but their behavior is different. I think a good research topic would be, how do you explain that? The gap between what they know and what they practice. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm not an academic, and so I'll approach this maybe a little differently. I'm a social worker by training, and I want to follow our speaker's lead to say that I acknowledge my ancestors, both the Celts and the Germans, as my biological ancestors and my adopted ancestors, the Native Americans in the Midwest. And I look at all three of those groups, and they have traditions of religious frame where the earth is seen as sacred. And I also have been raised a Christian and seen how Christianity has separated itself, not so much because it's not natural to Christianity, but as it came in opposition to earth-based religions, and seeing and fighting against that. It's a difficult topic because I know talking about religion brings up a lot of feelings quickly for people. So as I try to reconcile that, I see in what you were saying some aspects about how the sacred is represented in the very physical surroundings where we are and in our communities is important. Maybe you have a response to that. The second piece that I'd like to mention is that when I was traveling from Tamale to Mole, I see kilometer after kilometer of pipe being laid, trenches and water pipes going in. And there's a macroeconomic aspect to this, right? That there is a lot of money coming in that is part of a system that is alien to many of the communities where this is going in. When I traveled in the Volta in Pekki, I was told that there is access to municipal water, but many people don't have a CD to pay for it, and they will still take their water out of the river, out of the streams, and we're looking at biosands filtration, what have you, where people can make their own filters and go in and do that. Very active in East Africa, not so much in West Africa, and seeing how we can be helpful. But the last thing I want to do is be a Bill Clinton or Bono, right, and come in and be culturally not necessarily sensitive to each local condition. So I'm wondering if you could say something about economics and the macroeconomic system, how it gets in the way of looking at local culture.
Just want to find out whether you were able to establish a link between the changing family systems, urbanization, and the attitude that people have now adopted in managing their water and sanitation issues. From what you said, you asked, in a case study in the north, you asked two elderly people or an elderly person to give you two proverbs. And you realize that most of these proverbs are associated more with the elderly. Now with our changing family systems, where we are moving into nuclearization of families, where it's just the mother and then the children. Now we don't really have the members of the extended family members, that's the elderly, living with the young ones, who would have been able to impart such knowledge to their grandchildren. Do you think that there is also a link in the research that you're doing?
Relates to Prof. Gordon's question about the gap between behavior and, I guess, ideology. And I was wondering if you've had a look at all at structural adjustment programs in the 80s and the fact that government had to reduce spending on social services such as water and sanitation, whether that has impacted at all on, you know, the situation right now.
Before we continue, and then possibly close.
Okay. Actually, the last comment and your comment are similar in a way that you're asking about issues around economics and how it might get in the way of culture or either the ability to, at another level, provide wash facilities. Actually, I do have, I think I told Obadile, if I ad lib, I'll miss some things. But I do talk about what I describe as a disturbing trend in the wash sector, and that is where I start talking about the changing policies that are shaped by issues of money and finances, and where I talk about the shift in the focus in the wash sector from what they say was a needs approach to a demand approach has been happening in international development with the questioning of aid effectiveness. And so what that means is that and especially because of structural adjustment, where the role of the state in providing basic social services, including water and sanitation, has been, you know, under fire and under threat. And in fact, under SAPS, we know the state is told to withdraw from providing many social services for people. And that is also happening in terms of water and sanitation services. And the approaches that are being used call for, like I said, the dominant approach now in Ghana for sanitation is called community-led total sanitation. And that approach takes it as the premise that the first thing that you need to do is just to get people to stop open defecation. But beyond that, the approach is that people themselves will now build either, you know, pit latrines or something like that as they move from open defecation and up the so-called sanitation ladder, which of course the ideal in, you know, the dominant sense is that they will have a flushing toilet or something like that, when we know that, you know, that may not be appropriate for all societies, all people, based on, you know, their environment, their economic situation. So but people are being told now that INGOs, development actors or whatever, they're now going to provide the toilets themselves, which used to happen along with providing the water facilities. There is still provision, direct provision of wash facilities. NGOs and donors will come in, governments will do boreholes, they'll do small town water systems and things like that. But in terms of before, where they actually might help a family to actually have a toilet, a flush toilet or some form of something beyond, you know, dig and bury or a pit latrine, that is not happening anymore. Communities are told that you need to, you know, use your own resources to do that. And that is something that is pushing this, letting the state, to me, off the hook in terms of providing this the sanitation services, especially in some of the most poorest and most marginalized communities, where, as someone said here, you know, the cost of the materials and other things to build toilets is prohibitive to many people. The other area, the other linkage to that is that most of the development partners, whether it's the multilateral or bilateral institutions, right now 90 or 80% at a minimum of the resources that come for water sanitation and hygiene intervention in communities anyway is being funded by external donors. So the government of Ghana only uses less than 0.2% of their GDP to go towards individual and community provision of water and sanitation services and facilities. Of course, if we're talking about big infrastructure projects and things like that, that's a whole different story, because then the private sector is involved, and so people will, you can get money from the IMF or World Bank to do, you know, to build a dam or to do any kind of big, huge infrastructure water facility. The money will come for that. And even the water, because even to do roads and to build many other of these, all these big buildings and structures that you see, all of them need water to build. And but that will be there. But in terms of individuals and communities, you know, a different kind of phenomena is happening. And the approach, the dominant approach of the government of Ghana is based on an approach that is sanctioned by UNICEF, WHO, whoever. To me, that really sort of puts the government in to the side, or lets them off the hook in terms of, I think, what needs to happen for the right, the so-called right to wash, to be realized. And let's see.
The gap,
well, I think I'm glad, I think my presentation was to point out that the gap exists, and that we need to, you know, find a way to do the research and the work to fill the gap in the understanding that we need to have if we want to see the wider behavioral changes, collective and individual behavior changes that we have. Unfortunately, I did have some conversation about that. I just didn't get to that, as well as more discussions around the economics. But in the last part, I think, you asked the question about family changes,
yeah,
and the nuclear family, and how all of this may be impacting on what we see. That's possible. I haven't seen a lot of work connecting that issue to what is happening in terms of the practices, the sanitation and hygiene practices. But one of the things that I mentioned in terms of the areas of research, when I talked about needing to do more around child-rearing practices, obviously the social, you know, through the colonial and other kinds of processes, even my friend who talked about Western Christianity or different religions coming in, all of those things have shaped how people, you know, conceive of family and social interactions between individuals. And certainly with neoliberal culture, and Western and Christianity, the family unit is the mother, father, the child, and all of the extended family networks that we know was the basis of most other African societies. Those things do not become as central. But I know that in practice, African people still very much, you know, have those ties. But then is the transmission of the sacred knowledge or practices around hygiene and sanitation, the taboos, you know, things that we saw today, are those being transmitted from one generation to the next, from the elders to the youth? Do you think that the youth are interested in hearing what the elders have to say? I think that's for us to look at and see. But I think increasingly where people become more individualistic and it's all about me, we're in a me society, I, what I want, what I think, what I want to do. I think some of the social ways of monitoring and sanctioning behavior, definitely I think there's been some breakdown in that in rural communities as well, of course, in other areas and spaces that we find ourselves.
Okay. I have one question to ask. And my question is, from your experience on this project, how easy it is to change a people's belief system about something?
Well, I was trying to give some insight from some of the work in African psychology around social and human transformation, some of the understandings that is coming from the work in that area. And again, what I'm understanding now is that unless you understand the culture of a people and the symbolic, spiritual, and other meanings that they attach to what they do, and unless you understand the institutions, the social institutions that shape and help form the ideology behind the culture, you will not be able to come up with, whether it's those working in health, I guess, is where you hear more about behavior change, communication, and those kinds of messages. And so my point was saying that we need to understand this area of work and how it applies to African societies to be able to get the kind of social transformation to happen in terms of sanitation and hygiene practices that people say they want to see today.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we've had enough and I want to bring the curtain to a close. So on behalf of the director and fellows and students of the Institute, I want to thank you very much. But before that, I want us to appreciate her once more, or for the last time.
All right. Again, we'd like to thank Dr. Afia Zakiya, a.k.a. Mami Wata, for her excellent presentation. Also, give yourselves a big round of applause for showing up again in your numbers. We're glad to have you here. Next week, we have our very final presentation of the semester and also the end of my preeminent reign as coordinator for the seminar series. And that will be coming from Dr. Kwame Amwalabi, and he will be speaking on enjoy the dance, the topic, enjoy the dance, look for the flag meaning, dealing with the Asafo flags, the flag companies of those warriors of the Fante. So it should be a very interesting one. He says he has plenty of multimedia and videos for you to check out. So please, again, come and tell an African, telephone, television, whatever you need to do to tell them and let them come out to our final seminar. Thank you very much.